Attorney's Office, and Bacato for being here this evening. So at this time, I'm going to turn the meeting over to Stacey Mulholland. Stacey, thank you for putting this also together this evening.
Thank you very much. Good evening. I'm Stacey Mulholland. I'm supervisor up in Plumstead Township and a member of the Bucks County Association of Township Officials Board. And just thank you all for joining us this evening. Thank you, Mayor Saxton. Thank you, Bristol Borough, for hosting this event. We call it Yes in Your Backyard. The opioid and heroin crisis hits home. The rise in heroin and opioid abuse in Pennsylvania, it has no geographic boundaries. It crosses all socioeconomic groups, all ages, all races. Last January, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention announced that drug overdoses are now the leading cause of injury-related death in the U.S. More than 1.5 times as many people died from overdoses than motor vehicle collisions in 2014. EMS providers have directly witnessed the increase in the rate of drug overdose deaths, estimated at 137% over the last 15 years. From 2001 to 2014, nearly 500,000 people died from overdoses. Opioids cause nearly two-thirds of those deaths, meaning 78 people in the U.S. are dying every day from opioid overdoses. Here in Pennsylvania, 3,400 drug-related overdose deaths were reported in 2015. According to the DEA, that's an increase of 23% from 2014. In approximately 81 of those deaths, the presence of heroin or at least one opioid was reported. None of this comes as a surprise to our first responders. In 2014, EMS providers in the U.S. encountered more than 430,000 patients suspected of drug ingestion. They administered naloxone, a medication that reverses the deaths or reverses the effects of opioids and increases overdose patients' respiratory effort more than 150,000 times. Across the nation and here in Bucks County, our first responders are on the front line. Officials in Bucks and Montgomery counties anticipate the number of drug-related deaths to nearly double from 2015. This is a national epidemic. Our hometowns and our communities are in crisis. This evening, we are here, as I mentioned before, at the invitation of Betty Rodriguez, Bristol Borough Council Vice President, as well as the council. Thank you again for hosting this. Let me take a moment to introduce this evening's panel. We have Matt Weintraub, Bucks County native, Temple Law School's graduate. He was sworn in last fall as a Bucks County DA. Matt has spearheaded many of the DA's ongoing anti-heroin initiatives in recent years, among other anti-crime measures. Thank you for joining us. Anna Rosado, clinical director of Bucks County Drug and Alcohol Commission and Bucks County Drug Court. She has over 15 years of experience in working in the field of substance and co-occurring disorders, as well as the criminal justice population. The commission addresses prevention, education, intervention, and treatment needs for Bucks County residents, contracts with more than 30 agencies to provide prevention and treatment. Betty Rodriguez, Council Vice President of the West Ward. Betty works for the Bucks County Women's Healthcare and has served on Bristol Borough Council for 14 years. She's proud to be the first Latina to serve on council, and she's worked hard to address the demands on the police force due to the escalating drug crisis. We have Dan Rattlgan. He's currently president of Bacato, Bucks County Association of Township Officials. In addition, he serves as chairman of the Board of Supervisors in Upper Makefield Township, and he was recently appointed to the Board of Directors for Bucks County Drug and Alcohol. We have Chief Henry, Bristol Borough Police Chief. Chief Henry's worked in law enforcement for 31 years. And he's had been working in Toms River, New Jersey, where he rose through the ranks from patrolman to captain before retiring in 2014. And I believe you're celebrating your one-year anniversary here in Bristol Borough.
Almost.
Next month. Congratulations.
Thank you.
We have Scott Bonher, chief of Bucks County Rescue Squad. 82 years after its founding, Bucks County Rescue Squad provides pre-hospital emergency medical care to residents of Lower Bucks and surrounding communities. Additionally, the squad sponsors many specialty teams, including TEMS, tactical emergency support, including multiple law enforcement agencies, as well as Bucks County Police Major Incident, the MERT team, and you work very closely with Chief Henry to coordinate emergency services here in the borough. So thank you all for joining us tonight. And as I mentioned, we are here at the invitation of the council. Last February, Betty, you had asked the council to write a letter inviting District Attorney Weintraub here to discuss the heroin opioid epidemic in Bristol Borough. What prompted you to take that step?
Well, I work in an OBGYN office where, surprisingly, we have a lot of young women that are addicted and come to the office for their pregnancies. That's such a hard scene to see, young women addicted to Percocets or whatever it is, and they're pregnant, and there's nothing we can do until they deliver, and it's kind of frustrating to me to see all this addiction out there. It's just overwhelming to me. It starts there, but then also in my community, lately we've had a lot of overdoses that haven't ended well, and I see the frustration of the firefighters and the EMTs that actually their families are upset if, you know, they go back to the same house three times in one night, and people don't understand. Some people are very rude and negative about it, but that's somebody's child. And to me, it's not only an addiction, it's a sickness. So I wanted to do anything we could to bring you here, and I appreciate everyone that's here, including the audience. I'm very happy to see Norma Sullivan, who's the president of the Puerto Rican Culture Association. It's nice to see someone from the community who's a leader, and the parents and people that just came, including Brian Fitzpatrick, thank you for coming. Anyone that's here that's willing to stand with us and try to help anybody that needs the help they need. Thank you for coming.
Thank you again for inviting the panel, and this crisis has been fought at every level, whether it's local government, county government, and even state and federal. Last year, the state legislature passed, and then Governor Wolf signed into law two significant pieces of legislation, which is really has affected law enforcement's approach in dealing with the heroin opioid epidemic in Bucks. One was Act 139, the Good Samaritan Law, and the other Act 199, the Prescription Drug Monitoring Law. This is the county's lead law enforcement officer. Can you tell us how these two pieces of legislation have affected law enforcement?
I will. Thank you, Stacey. First of all, Betty, thank you very much, and Ralph, thank you, and Mayor Saxton, I appreciate you extending the invitation. This is such a critical issue. I just came from Bristol Township. I feel like I'm at a different place every night, but the message is too important. And sometimes, Betty, I know it feels like it's overwhelming to deal with such large numbers, but I think we need to focus, like you said, on this person or that person, somebody's child, and perpetuating the message of hope. That's what I'd like you to take out of this. It's easy for me to sit back and lock everybody up, and candidly, if somebody's breaking into your homes or stealing your car, that's exactly what we're going to do because we have to protect you, but we also want to make sure that people get the treatment they need. And these two laws are great examples of that. They're state laws, they're not federal laws, and the first one is the Good Samaritan Law. And just to break it down very briefly, it has a couple of critical components. The first one is that anybody that needs life-saving Narcan can get it. You don't need a prescription anymore. There's a standing prescription from the state on down. You can walk into your local drugstore now and get it at most drugstores. And if you don't want to wait, you can go down to Warminster to Bucks County Drug and Alcohol Commission. I think it's on Mondays and Tuesdays, Anna?
There's a flyer outside, and it's Mondays and Tuesdays between 10 and 1 at the 600 Lewis Drive address in Warminster. Now, we understand that individuals work. So between 10 and 1 are walk-in services. You don't need to call ahead of time or anything like that. But if you can't make it between those hours and you need to come in another day, please call our office because we will try to coordinate it so that someone is available to see you and help you obtain Narcan. It's free. You'll get, once you see the video and talk with us, you'll get your own Narcan free of charge.
And thank you, Anna. I just want to reiterate, it is not a cure, but it is a lifesaver, and you can't cure somebody if they're dead. So obviously, it's so critical. And to speak to that for a second about the success that we've had here in Bucks County, we really have grasped onto this as a lifesaver and gotten it into the hands of our first responders. Now, I'm sure that we'll hear a little more about this from Scott because of some of the frustration perhaps, but we felt that it was imperative that our police, when they respond first to an overdose scene, that they're armed with this. And since we've implemented the program, I'm proud to say we have 100% coverage of every Bucks County citizen is now within reach of a police officer that carries this lifesaver. And since we've implemented the program, police alone, forget about EMS and fire and private citizens and hospitals, police alone have saved 293 lives. And that is nothing, obviously, no small number. So that's number one. The second part of the law, the Good Samaritan law, as it's called, is, and to encapsulize this in one phrase, it's don't run, call 911. The legislature, state legislature, has decided that it's more important to save a life than to make a prosecution. Whether I agree with that or not is really not material. I'm sworn to uphold the law, and this is the law as it is. And what it says is, if you yourself, any person in this room, or even a person that might be under the influence of narcotics or has narcotics themselves, makes a phone call because somebody that they're with is overdosing on narcotics, and you are truthful and honest and cooperative on that phone call to 911, neither you nor the overdosing person will be prosecuted. Even if you're holding drugs or drug paraphernalia and that overdosing person is doing the same. That's because it's more important to save a life than to make a prosecution. That's the determination that's been made. So that's the first law. The second law has to do with the prescription drug monitoring program. And what it enables doctors and pharmacists to do now is to check on a patient that may be pharmacy shopping or doctor shopping. They now have access to a database that's cross-referenced all over the state. It could be a little better, and I understand there's some laws in committee right now that to tighten that up and to make it go from state to state. We live right across the river from New Jersey, so somebody that really needs to get these medications is going to be smart enough to do that. But at the least, our doctors and our pharmacists here have access to this database and can prevent that kind of doctor shopping and pharmacy shopping that we see so frequently.
Scott, would you mind walking us through a call that you would receive where you resuscitate, revive somebody with Narcan?
Sure. Typically, there's a variety of methods by which a prospective overdose is called in. Typically, it comes to the 911 system, and if the individual is known to family or friends as being a drug abuser, or have the potential to be an overdose, it will be described as being a potential overdose with specific indicators, which I'll explain. Otherwise, it can come in as an unconscious person or an individual that is just not acting appropriate. Once it's determined or fits kind of the criteria as we're discussing, an overdose will typically present itself with a trifecta that we look at. Unconsciousness, not breathing or inadequate breathing, and pinpoint pupils. Those three are the three primary indicators for the administration of naloxone, and that's typically how we will find these people. With the advent of naloxone in the hands of police, which I do totally support, I think that tool in that toolbox has, I know it has saved countless lives in this community and in Bristol Township. We've seen the positive effects of it. But what I think is vitally important to realize is it is a tool. It is one tool in a toolbox. Because just like any other medication that's out there, it has a specific amount of time for which it is useful in your bloodstream. After that amount of time, which is usually less than the bad stuff is there, is metabolized, once the naloxone is metabolized out of the system, if there are still opioids in their system, they will be re-overdosed. And that's very important for the general public to recognize. Just because they have received naloxone and they are breathing again, doesn't mean that they're out of the woods. There is a chance for them to become unconscious and stop breathing again after the administration of naloxone.
Some of the questions that we've heard, Dan and I have been doing this along with Matt for like a year and a half now, and one of the questions is, can a well-intentioned friend or bystander cause harm by administering the wrong amount of Narcan?
Now, these medications are relatively safe. Relatively safe. There are some things that through the educational process it's easy to get across. Typically, the doses that are available to the citizens are very small, enough to do the job. Some of the concerns that you would run into or that you could see is vomiting after the administration, and that's why we try to tell citizens and other partnering first responders to put the victim on their side afterwards in case they vomit. But other than that, no, there's really no side effect to the drug. It's relatively safe to use in the doses that you have.
That the public has access to. Is that a different dosage that the rescue squads or physicians or police carry than if somebody from the public was to go pick up a dose?
Yeah, there's three primary packaging sources that are out there where it could be sprayed up their nose. We call it a mucosal atomizing, and that's anywhere from 0.4 milligrams up to 2 milligrams, and in some cases 4 milligrams. And the higher doses is because of its transference through the tissues to get to where it needs to go. So the higher the dose, so that you get some rather than not enough. So, but the other areas of law enforcement, you'll see the auto injectors that are out there. Those auto injectors are 0.4 milligrams, not even a half a milligram. And then in an EMS world, we carry it in 2 milligram dosages. And the whole goal, it's not to have them wake up and go out and play a game again. The whole goal is to give enough for them to start breathing. Mm-hmm. That's it. Once you give enough for them to start breathing normally, you've done the job. It gives EMS the opportunity to provide additional supportive care and transport them to the hospital. Because they could have other drugs on board or have ingested other drugs other than just opioids that can cause additional problems as well.
Chief Henry, as of December, police in Pennsylvania had saved more than 2,100 lives using Narcan. While Narcan is saving lives, all agree more needs to be done to reverse the growing epidemic. In an article back in February, you expressed frustration. You were seeking an addiction law enforcement strategy. Currently, there's a new countywide initiative in cooperation with the district attorney's office, and actually, Bocato was pleased to submit a letter of support for that. It's called BPAR, Bucks Police Assisting in Recovery. Can you give us some information? The innovative program will give individuals who are struggling with substance abuse an opportunity to connect with treatment, as well as offering them an alternative to incarceration. And just piggybacking on what Scott said about reviving them and then transporting them to the hospital, sometimes from what we've heard at these panel discussions, that doesn't always go down so well. So if you'd like to talk about BPAR and that initiative, the warm handoff, as it's called sometimes.
Warm handoff, that was a good one.
First, again, thanks for coming this evening. This has been a very important issue for our police department. Mayor Saxton's been a big push behind us getting it really out in front with us and trying to attack this issue. And it is very taxing on our agency. It really taxes our resources. Thanks to our partnership with the rescue squad, they are saving countless lives. I think, Scott, we talked about some of the numbers just before we got here, and some of the numbers are pretty disturbing. In the borough alone last year, there was 156 overdose calls, and 13 which resulted in fatalities. So for a small community such as ours, it's very disheartening, and it's a true problem. The BPAR program that the district attorney's office has really been pushing hard on the police departments has started a less of a fear-based program. Of course, anybody that's on drugs or is under the influence of narcotics, the last thing they're going to do is, well, I'm going to go see the police. That's the last thing you think they're going to want to do. So what we've kind of done is they followed the model of the safe haven with the children. If somebody wanted to abandon a child, you know, a police department, a fire department will take them without question. Basically, what it is now is this program is training individuals to be navigators. So if an individual shows up on our doorstep and they have an issue regarding heroin addiction, narcotics addiction, even if they're under the influence at that time, and not at the level of requiring medical treatment, they can contact a trained navigator who will basically transport them to a rehabilitation center. There's been a big push, again, from the district attorney's office, some of the bigger police departments with more resources have really been able to jump on board quickly with this, Ben Salem, Middletown. What we're going to do, and I spoke to the district attorney about this even yesterday, is we're going to be able to piggyback with them. There's really no boundaries with this. Those navigators will be available to us, and we're working through that process right now. I think his goal is, of course, to make it countywide. And it's really an innovative program.
Right.
It is going to be, you know, there's still going to be that little bit of rub there. It's the police and a narcotic situation. What is, just like the district attorney said, is that, yeah, it's illegal, but if somebody's coming for help, that's always our number one priority, is to save a life, and life safety is what we do, and we always prioritize that before everything else, so we're hoping it's going to be successful.
Like you had just said, it's an innovative program, it's something new, and we're really fortunate to live in a county that has committed to providing services to our residents and making a quality of life and safety a priority. Bucks County's Health and Human Services Division accounts for nearly 50% of the county's operating budget. The county's Drug and Alcohol Commission falls within that scope. So, Anna, can you provide an overview of the background of the commission and the services that are offered through DNA?
The Bucks County Drug and Alcohol Commission is responsible for the administration and management of public funds, and we provide funding for treatment for individuals who are uninsured. We provide funding for intervention and prevention programs. So we work throughout the county with different providers to be able to provide treatment at all levels of care, including medication-assisted treatment. We also provide engagement efforts. We provide funding for assessments, programming through the grade schools and high schools to get to identify individuals who are in need of treatment or prevention services throughout the county.
One of the issues that we've heard a lot about are parents trying to cope with their child's addiction. What options are out there for that situation?
And that's a great question, because the problem with addiction, it's not just that individual who's trying to recover. It's a family, it's a loved one, a support system, anyone who's involved with that individual to get in recovery and to support that individual. So many times parents who find out that their child or their loved one is using, they don't know what to do. They don't know where to go. And that's one of the reasons why the commission's there, to help, you know, help support that family in this process, to educate. So one of the things that we do is we have, you know, Act 53, we support Act 53, and that's for adolescents between the ages of 12 and 17. If you're a parent and you have a child between the ages of 12 and 17 and you have evidence that they're using, regardless of the substance, there is a way that you could help that child get into treatment. So you would contact our office, and we would help you walk through the system to get that child in front of a judge to be able to, you know, if necessary, mandate treatment. There's a flyer out there on the table that talks about Act 53.
That was one of the questions that we've had over and over at these different forums, parents that are struggling with that issue. There's another source for information. It's pretty valuable. It's from the Commonwealth Prevention Alliance. It's called PA Stop. Great resource. Can you walk us through that?
Sure. PA Stop is a campaign that basically states anyone can be addicted. It does not matter where you're from, the color of your skin, your socioeconomic background. Anyone could be addicted, and there's a flyer out there about PA Stop showing, you know, it's something that's across, you know, everywhere. So PA Stop, you go online, it educates you about addiction and also connects you to resources that are available in the county.
Thank you. Dan Rattlgan. So this is, Bocato's done a couple of these forums for the past year and a half or so. What propelled Bocato into being a local government leader on this issue? As I mentioned, we just signed a letter of support for this county initiative with the Department of Justice.
The type of stuff that Picato deals with is more city municipal-related type things, like unfunded mandates, stormwater management, police departments, fire departments, that type of thing, zoning ordinances. It dawned on us that almost every municipality and borough in the county has this problem in one way, shape, or form. Some more than others, but in every single municipality and borough. So what Cato realized was that maybe we could lend a hand to this problem. And as we started to kind of go through this, we had some of the first Narcan training. We can actually take a little bit of credit working with Matt on getting Narcan in most of the police cars today in the county. It wasn't easy, but it was done. We can also talk about the fact that we know there's a problem. It's on the news every day. It's now being talked about in Washington. It's the thing. What Picato's mission isn't necessarily to jump on top of a popular topic. Picato's mission is to try and assist its ways in how to solve this problem from a municipal standpoint. That means soliciting state and federal government for funding for police departments, as an example. Law enforcement is desperately looking for money to help with this. Municipalities like Bensalem, 75% of their budget is police. They are in a major crisis right now. Middletown, slightly less, but again, a crisis. It's working its way across the county. So it's a county problem. It's our problem at this point. Mm-hmm. So there's not only awareness that it's there, which we kind of read about it. There's also a statistic that I heard 2 years ago that I'm willing to bet is different today, and that was for every 12th person in this room, they know somebody or are related to somebody that's had the problem. That number, I'm willing to bet, is even less. The CDC has already reported that 500,000 people in the last 10 years have died from this. It is by far the worst drug crisis this country has ever seen. So it's a combination of these types of forums. It's the combination of the message that we give you to take out of here to talk about. It's the message of the videotape that municipalities are going to ask the borough for a copy to play on their stations. So there's an awareness. Because if we all don't play a part in this, it's never going to get resolved. It's not like, you know, cowboys and Indians, folks. This is everywhere. This has crossed every socioeconomic level. It is everywhere. And it doesn't make sense. It's not, you know, oh, bad kid problem. No, good kids have the same problem. So it's huge.
As was mentioned, education and prevention are measures and key components in stemming the drug abuse. Chief Henry, it was reported that you were bringing DARE back to the schools. Please tell us about that decision.
Well, we were fortunate enough to have a Sergeant Rivera return to us after military leave, and the council and the school administration agreed that it would be a benefit for everybody in town, including, most importantly, our young children, to have the police back into the school. The DARE program has changed quite a bit. Instead of just drug, alcohol, resistance education, it's more about consequence and really pushing that aspect of it and making right choices at that time. For me, I felt that the biggest aspect and benefit of it is the interaction, again, with the police officer and the school children. So, God forbid that we're into the situation that we're at now, like I said, crossing that threshold with the BPAIR program. You know, the first time you have interaction with a police officer is in a negative consequence. We don't want that. It's much more important for us to make that impact with our school children at this point and really grow with them as they grow through the years. So, especially in a small community such as this, there's really no better grounds for this to happen. And so that's why we really took advantage of it, and everybody's been on board with it.
Anna, unfortunately for some, addiction goes hand in hand with criminal activities, as I guess you all can attest to. We hear a lot about drug court and treatment courts. Does Bucks County have a drug court, and are we really seeing the effectiveness from it?
So Bucks County does have a drug court. We started in 2010, and it's we've had multiple individuals have applied and gone through the program. It is a three-year, it's a 12-month to 30-month program. It's made up of four phases, and each individual is in each phase for a minimum of 90 days, maximum, whatever it takes for them to kind of achieve those goals. We have a 59.5 graduation rate and a 13% recidivism rate. So our drug court program is pretty successful. It's open to the public on Thursdays. Drug court sessions are, matter of fact, it was today, at 1 o'clock. So it's open to the public. You come in and really see what it takes. The drug court team is made up of two judges. We have three probation officers, myself, we have a public defender, we have a district attorney, and it's really a team approach. And our goal is recovery, but also providing those life skills to these individuals who've been using for a very long time. We provide them with any kind of support services. They're in treatment, so treatment is primary. Job connection, job skills, working. If they can't work, they have to do community service in some way. So it's been really successful, and it's a very supportive environment. You know, we're not trying to sanction everyone, anyone. We're really trying to support them to make better decisions.
So looking ahead, as I mentioned, Bocato wrote a letter of support for the BPARA program. We have a legislative committee, and we've been reviewing several different bills in possibly supporting or writing letters of support, letting our legislators know that these are important bills for our communities. Dan, can you just give a rundown of some of these bills that are out there?
Yeah, so to kind of give you an idea, when a legislator or a senator writes a bill, they're obviously doing it for a reason. They'll in some cases ask for associations like ours to review those bills and to provide some guidance and in some cases endorsements of those bills. Because in our case, we represent essentially Bucks County. So currently there are seven proposed bills that the House has. So the first is House Bill 988 by Representative Mert, which increases penalties for drug trafficking offenses. Second one is House Bill 1511, which Gene DiGirolamo has, creates an emergency addiction treatment fund by taxing the sales of opiates in Pennsylvania. Third one is House Bill 1568, again Gene DiGirolamo, requires protective service workers to receive training in addiction and how to make appropriate referrals for assessment and treatment. House Bill 1294, again Gene, requires prescribers to check the PMP database. That's this database that they're talking about. In Pennsylvania, we have a database that's just started. However, 43 states are part of what's called a national database, which eventually we will become a part of that as our software becomes friendly with the national database software. House Bill 1692 outlines involuntary treatment requirements and procedures for individuals suffering from alcohol and other drug abuse. That's Representative Redshaw. House Bill 1748, Representative Mahoney, outlines requirements for K-12 courses of study on drug and alcohol abuse and requires instructors to be trained to better recognize students who may be using or abusing alcohol, drugs, or other dangerous controlled substances. House Bill 2128, Representative Heffley, requires placement of Narcan in recovery residence. And finally, House Bill 355, which is Tina Davis's bill, establishes certification for recovery residents. Yesterday, the House Human Services Secretary Price in Washington basically gave a speech, and his speech was about this crisis. And he talked about allocating $847 million to this to all 50 states. Now, admittedly, it's $10 million a state pretty much. Washington is trying. What we experience in this, and not that we're experts, is everybody's trying everything that they can within reason. It's not solving the problem. So the outreach that we're trying to do and the attention is the kind of the second phase of it, so that everybody's acutely aware of this, so that when you read in the paper, as an example, and the chief will tell you, if there's a bunch of break-ins with cars, there's a good chance that it's an addict that's doing it. Simple type crimes, it's an addict. Anything you see that's funny out there, call the police. At the same time, think about the prevention side of it. We will never, ever resolve this if we're dealing with strictly the back end of this or the recovery side of it. Not that we're leaving people out in the cold, because we need to take care of them as human beings, but we need to be thinking about the front end, because when demand goes down, the problem goes down.
Bucks County, working with local officials like Dan, Betty, Ralph, law enforcement like Chief Henry, community coalitions, nonprofits, businesses, has been a leader in the Commonwealth, if not the country, for the prescription drug take-back days. The sites in Bucks County have collected over 40 tons of unused prescription drugs over the last 6 years or so. Matt, what do you attribute to the secret of Bucks County's success, and when is the next take-back day?
I'm glad you asked. It's the next take-back day is April 29th. That's right. It's around the corner. And the good news is you don't have to wait, actually. Most of the police stations have take-back boxes. I know the closest one here, because they have to be secured, is in Bristol Township, but it's right down the road. And on the 29th, we'll have, I think, 50 sites all across the county where you can bring your unused, expired or old medications to put them back in the box here. And what you're doing is you're doing three things. You're saving the ground from these toxins, you're saving the water from being poisoned, and you're saving a person who's going to potentially divert that medication. That's what we find, that most of the time when we have our old unused medications, we leave them in places that we know we can get access to them quickly, which is the medicine cabinets, our kitchen counters. And unfortunately, the drug addicted know that too. So most of the times when those medicines are diverted from us, they're taken by people we know, people we trust, people we love. It could be a worker passing through your house. It could be a relative. It could be a friend. It could be your son or your daughter. Unfortunately, that's what happens. So a couple of things I'd like you to know, and to end this part of the topic on a positive note, is that you can do something. And you don't have to wait until April 29th. You can do it anytime you like. It's like taking a movie and putting it back in a red box, or for us. I hate to put myself in this category, but old timers, it's like mailing a letter in one of those old, post office mailboxes. It clangs shut, and then we take those drugs, those unused medications, and we incinerate them. And as Stacy pointed out, we've incinerated 80,000 pounds and counting since we started this program. We are number one in the state, ahead of Philadelphia, ahead of Pittsburgh, ahead of Monco, and I want to keep being number one, and I want to hit 100,000 pounds within the next couple of months. And you asked a great question, and that is, why do we do such a good job at this? Some people say to me, why do Bucks Countyans have so much medication? Everybody has so much medication. What I think we are doing well here in Bucks County, we have retrained our brains. We've shifted the thought process. Now Bucks Countyans know, just like Dan always says, to wear your seatbelt when you drive in a car. Bucks Countyans know you don't leave your medication out there for somebody to grab. You don't save it for the next time. You don't give it to your cousin. You dump it in the box and let us get rid of it. And we are now the leader in the state in that movement.
In every single take back, we've always been the leader in the state.
Can I say one more thing to that, actually?
Yes, you can.
So we've noticed an interesting phenomenon, and this is a positive. Our semi-annual, twice a year, take back days, we still are the leaders in the state, but the actual poundage has been going down slightly. Yet our overall number every year is still going up. And what I take that to mean is people aren't even waiting for that twice a year day, that take back day. They now know they can go any day they want and make a deposit in this green box, and we'll take it from there. So everybody should be congratulated. Spread the word, April 29th, if not sooner.
And they're usually 9 to noon or 10 to noon?
I think it's 10 to 2.
10 to 2. Do you happen to know where the... Do you do it here in the building, Chief?
Here in Borough.
Okay.
Borough Town Hall, 10 to 2, 29th Saturday.
Just
Just as we end this portion, I'd like to ask Betty, Ralph, thank Betty, Ralph, Mayor, Lorrain, for inviting and assembling this panel tonight, and see if, it's been a tremendous service to the residents to get this information, to provide access, let you know what Bucks County is doing on this issue. And if you wanted to just add any comments?
Yeah, I wanted to say thank you, first of all, for everyone that's here. And I think the most important thing is information. If the residents have information, then they can seek treatment. I've seen people struggle trying to get their kids in the facilities, and most of the time insurance is the problem. But I heard Anna say earlier that it doesn't matter with your organization if they have insurance or not, right?
So if individuals have no insurance, they could be in their Bucks County residents, they could be funded through the Bucks County Drug and Alcohol Commission. And in order to access that funding stream, you have to go to one of our assessment sites. The closest we have, you know, in Lower Bucks, we have Cadenzia, that's right there at the Lower Bucks Hospital. They're a 24/7 assessment site. So if somebody who's involved with BPAIR or someone who's overdosed, the assessment is available through Cadenzia at our Lower Bucks Hospital site. There's Pyramid of Bristol, which is right by the old Delhaas, the Taco Bell, the Bucks County Office Center. They also do assessments. And Aldi and Langhorne, which is right by the Oxford Valley Mall. So all those places will take individuals who have no insurance and assess them. If they have medical assistance, they could access the same assessment sites. And if they have private insurance, in the back of your insurance card, there's a number that usually says for substance abuse or mental health treatment. You give that number a call, and they will connect you with the place that has that's within your network and provide the assessment. So the first step is getting assessment.
Yes, and excuse me. I also want to say thank you to Anna, who's also a Bristol resident, and it's nice to see someone from Bristol coming to support this organization and what we're trying to fight against. And I thank everyone here. Like I said, it's hard and frustrating when you see so much addiction out there, especially in young pregnant women, and that's where I work, so that's where I see it first. And then to see it in the neighborhoods and hear about, you know, the overdoses. And I get a little upset when some people say, oh, I don't use the Narcan, and they don't understand, you know, it's someone's child. And I, you know, I'm fortunate enough that hopefully it'll never be none of mine, but it's hard. You have to sit in their shoes to understand where they're coming from. And thank you, Anna. Thank you, everyone. I really appreciate you guys coming with this information.
Thanks for reaching out. Ralph, did you have some comments?
I'd just like to, again, thank everybody for being here this evening. It is an epidemic that's, you know, affects everybody. It's, you know, could be our own children. I'm sure we all had, and I know I did personally, have family members addicted to heroin and different things like that, and seeing what it does to a family and how it breaks up your family. And Dan mentioned earlier, it doesn't matter where you come from.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can be the richest person or the poorest person. Once it hits, it hits. And it's a very hard drug to break away from. It's, you know, it takes over your life. And, you know, providing this Narcan to people, it's somebody's child. It's somebody's son or daughter. And I think that the hardest thing is when I talk to elderly people, they don't know how to handle it. I think Matt said that earlier. It's hard for a parent to understand it's in their 60s or 70s that their grandchild mm-hmm. is hooked on some kind of a drug, or on their daughter or their son that they've been dealing with their whole life. And then their families have to see, you know, at a Christmas dinner or at a family function, you know, somebody's falling asleep at the table. It's just a bad scene, but it's a parent, still somebody's child. And that parent wants to do anything they can to make sure that that child gets the best help they can. And sometimes it works. I mean, it only takes one time for a light bulb to go on, and, you know, you can turn somebody's life around. So I say never give up on anybody, because, again, it could be anybody's child out there. And I don't look down on anybody that has this kind of problem. If there's anything I would want to do is to help them and try to get in recovery and do what we can for him. So, Scott, I know you guys work hard. I know the chief works hard. Anna, thank you, and thank you for representing Bristol. We're very proud of you. And Matt, thanks for coming down, and Dan.
Thank you.
And Stacey, you're always...
Yes, thank you, Stacey.
Thank you, guys. Mayor, Lorrain, anything to add?
Yeah, as the mayor, I have the responsibility to ensure that the public safety aspect is covered in town. I think that we can accomplish that, and we are accomplishing it from what I call through the three E's, which is education, which we're doing tonight, enforcement, and emergency services. The ability to do this all comes from the cooperation aspect that we have with the mayor and council, police chief, and emergency services all working together, and then bumping that up to working with, you know, district attorney's office, the drug and alcohol commission, and the township officials association. Additionally, working with police chief Henry and the entire police department, whose untiring efforts, and I've only been here since November again, but I've seen their efforts 24/7 in working on this opium and drug epidemic that we have throughout the county and its effect on our local residents. Also, too, we're fortunate in the borough, our fire chief Herb Slack and his EMTs at Bristol Fire Company Number 1 went out and got a federal grant to purchase Narcan training, and they respond in assisting with Scott Banner and the rescue squad. So it's a coordinated effort within our town, everybody cooperating together, working very hard, and then working with the county. So it'll be a home run no matter what we do.
It is definitely a coordinated effort and takes, you know, all levels of government working together, community resources, and we are, you know, seeing success where you guys are saving lives. So we, you know, need to keep working and plugging along, even though sometimes it doesn't seem like we're just treading water, but we are saving lives. You guys are saving lives. Lorrain?
I was speaking to a 15-year-old girl tonight, and she told me that her mother was addicted to opiate drugs, and she said that her mother was selling them, getting them and selling them. She said, I wish the doctors wouldn't give, they would have a higher standard. She said, it upsets me so much because my mom would, like you were talking about, shop around for drugs, and now she's living with an aunt, you know, and this is a 15-year-old beautiful child telling me this. And, you know, we say that it's somebody's child, it's somebody's parent, it's somebody's grandparent. If you have a back injury and some doctor gives you drugs and you continually, you know, take these drugs and then you end up, you can't get them any longer, what happens to you? You go out and you go on the street and you look for heroin. It's not just a kid. It's not just a parent. It could be a grandparent, a cousin, anyone. And I have a few cousins in my family that are going through it right now, and they're in treatment. And brilliant people. You know, it doesn't matter. It affects everyone. And it's so important for people to have that compassion and to continue. Like Ralph said, you have to continue to give them a chance because there's always that chance that they're going to get better, you know. And that's just, you know, tonight, I mean, right before I came here, this happened, so.
And that's why we called it Yes in Your Backyard, because it's happening in every town, every neighborhood. No community is immune from this epidemic. So there's a gentleman who's had his hand up in the back. If you could come up to the podium and speak into the microphone.
Jose Acevedo. Our country as a whole is addicted to prescription medication. If you look at TV, every other commercial is for one drug or the other. We've had doctors arrested for prescribing, I think they're just called pill doctors. I remember years ago I was struck by the fact that when somebody robbed a pharmacy, they weren't even going for the cash register. They were going right to the OxyContin. That's what they wanted because they know there's value per pill in each pill. Are there any safeguards when the doctor prescribes medication like that, that they're not over-prescribing to their patients? Because sometimes, like, one reason why we return a lot of drugs is, let's say you only need drugs for 30 days, but they give you a 90-day supply. Well, you got 60 pills laying around. I used to walk my dog down the river, and I would hear these kids, 12, 13, 14 years old, talking about the pills that they had access to. It was amazing. I just struck. Well, yeah, last night I had this pill. Last night I had And that's the great thing about the drop boxes. We're getting rid of them drugs, but I think we're just overly medicated, which leads to heroin, all these other issues. So I'd like to see some laws put in place to where these doctors cannot overprescribe the residents and their patients, because it's just a gateway to something else. Like they were saying, if you don't have that pill, you're going to go do something else. And it's just an epidemic.
Is it PA Stop that really talks about that and questions that, you know, if the doctor's going to write a prescription or you're going for a procedure or anything from wisdom teeth on, to ask those questions. So there's a lot of information on that website for maybe kids aren't going to go to that website, but parents and grandparents can go to that website and learn just about many of the points that you bring up.
There is a law today. It went into effect January 1st of this year. And Matt, correct me if I'm wrong. In the state of Pennsylvania, I believe a doctor can only write a script for up to 10 days, is it?
I thought it might have even been 5 days.
5 days. Jersey's done exactly the same thing for what you're talking about. Okay. However, the doctor has the option to extend that script if it's a reoccurring event. So if it's somebody with a chronic back pain problem or whatever, you know, they probably can get more. It's for the newbies, basically, that you don't want to get a 30-day script.
Right.
Because there's been too many statistics that prove that 30 days leads to another 30, sure, leads to that ultimate problem that we're petrified of.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
I would like to bring up one comment associated with this. That's a great comment. My wife practices emergency medicine, and she's limited on what she can provide by prescription. But one of the issues that she runs into, and that's the satisfaction scores by patients, that goes directly to payment by insurance companies. So Press Ganey evaluates these patient ratings, and when my wife or her colleagues don't prescribe the number of pills that this individual wants, they get a poor rating or an unsatisfactory rating. That goes right back to the physician reimbursement rates by the government through insurance programs. Okay. So this is a 360-degree problem that really has to be evaluated. It's not just the doctors or the pharmacists. It's also the insurance companies and the payers on the back end that feed this problem.
That's an excellent point.
And if I could add, it's important for education, for family members to be educated about opiates, the necessity for the medication, limiting it, restricting access to it if you do need it, being very careful, or you're giving it to your child or your loved one, counting the pills, getting rid of them through a prescription take back once the pain is gone. I know our agency, we go out throughout the community and we educate families about, you know, opiates and how they work in the brain and the necessity to manage that, and really educate family members and what are the dangers of using opiates, or, you know, how do you manage if you are in recovery, and communicating that to the doctor, I'm in recovery, I don't want opiates. So
I'd like to add on to what Anna just said. Once you get that script and you take it to the pharmacy, the pharmacy's going to fill it. You can't ask for half of what you've been prescribed. So that's a done deal. But you can speak to your doctor. Anna alluded to this. You can speak to your doctor, especially on behalf of your kids, but even if it's on behalf of yourself, and say, listen, doc, I'm really nervous. You're giving me a script for, these are essentially pain pills. They're not going to help me get better. Just help me feel better. I don't really need all of these, and I am willing to come back if I need more. Please only give me a script for 5 days instead of 30 days. I'm willing to come back. And I think people don't realize that. They're intimidated by their doctor because the doctor knows best. But this is our lives we're talking about here. So I do think it's good to self-advocate when you're at the doctor.
That's a good point, that there is some control that we have in, you know, initiating this and preventing it to some degree, even if it's just, you know, going to a website to get some information and following up with your doctor, you know, when you have that visit.
And I also know from working in the doctor's office, and I've been there a long time, they have a program now called Care 360. So sometimes we give a script to someone and we look in Care 360 and we see that they're getting them from this doctor and that doctor and that doctor. We take it upon ourselves to call the pharmacy and find out, how many they're getting and where they're getting them, and we stop it. I mean, it just seems like everybody all around has to work on this. Because, I mean, if they can get it, they're going to get it. It could be to take it, and it could be to sell it. People do do that. But I think that's one of the best programs out there, because you can actually see what they're getting and where they're getting and how many they're getting.
All good points. Well, there's no further questions. Just once again, like to thank everybody for joining us. Chief Anna, District Attorney Weintraub, Matt, and Dan here. And again, the council and mayor for this evening's allowing us to come here and do this presentation. Thank you.
Thank you for responding.
Yeah.
We appreciate it.